Start by thanking Tazir. Okay. Yeah, there we go. It sounds very important, as he said, with me being a dean at the University of Winnipeg, but you know what they say, being a dean at a university is like being a caretaker at a cemetery. There's a lot of people under you, but nobody listens. And that's really about the way it is. But anyway, it's an honor for me this evening to introduce Joe Renzulli. I put on my shirt with buttons for you. I suppose I should make just quick obligatory remarks about his scholarship and professionalism and contributions to gifted education, but it's stuff everybody knows about all the publications, the books, the programs, all the models, the revolving door enrichment triad model, school-wide enrichment model, and bringing gifted education into the 21st century technology-wise with the Renzulli learning system. But tonight, I think Joe will add a more personal dimension and address the fact that too often in gifted education, we perhaps over-focus on the intellectual piece and sometimes neglect and sometimes totally ignore the element of values and morality. Ben Franklin said it was a great mistake to think about giftedness and about greatness without thinking about goodness. And I've known Joe a long time, and he's always had an incredible spirit of service. And he shares generously, he's giving of his time, of his expertise. And he goes everywhere. Any of you from anywhere, probably Renzulli has been there. He comes up to Winnipeg, sometimes in January, to work with educators, and I'm sure there's many places he would rather be than Winnipeg in January. But he does it because he genuinely wants to make a difference. So by virtue of his unique professional skills and the way he's lived his life, I think Joe is uniquely positioned to speak to us about helping young people develop their creativity and their talents to make the world a better place. So with that, Joe, you're on.
Thank you very much, Ken. It's a great pleasure to be here, and I'm honored to be able to give an address. World Council holds a special part in my heart because it not only is an organization that I've been associated with for many years, but it always gives me an opportunity to get together with many of our international friends, former international students who have been at our university, and so it's a great pleasure to be here. I'm the only thing standing between you and a very nice reception that's been planned in the room next door. And so my 2.5 hour speech is going to, I'm going to speed things along. There will be copies of this available, Tassir, is that correct? That can be made available. You've been sitting a long time, so I'm going to move along fairly rapidly, skipping over a few slides that may take more time to explain than you want to put in. I always prepare an outline. Sometimes I follow it, but I'd like to go over these 5 points. And I'm a bit of a quoteaholic. I love this Einstein quote: "Not everything that can be counted counts, and not everything that counts can be counted." And I think that one of the things that we are in the area of psychology and education and identifying students for gifted programs, we sometimes get obsessed with the numbers and the cutoff scores and things like that. My work has focused on really two major questions and two related questions in giftedness. And the first one is, who are they? And I've spent many years working on that. Ken referred to some of my earlier work, Three-Ring Conception of Giftedness. And then the second thing is, how do we develop it? That's been the focus of my work for the past four decades. But over that time, a couple of related questions have developed, and that's the focus of tonight's remarks. What causes some people to use their gifts in socially constructive ways? People that I like to call social action entrepreneurs, rather than entrepreneurs that are just trying to make a lot of money. And then the second question related, how do we promote more of this socially constructive giftedness? And it really tries to tie together three things that I've been working on for quite some time. Conceptions of giftedness in the lower right, obviously, half of my life's work, the three-ring conception of giftedness. Leadership for the new century. The world is changing very rapidly, and one of the things that we're in great need of is leaders in all walks of life, and so that's related here. And then again, the production of social capital, which I will be defining as we move along. So we'll start with one of my favorite quotes by Nelson Mandela. He actually appears twice in tonight's presentation. A good head and a good heart are always a formidable combination, and so I guess if this work relates to any part of the anatomy, it may relate a little bit more to the heart than it does to the head, although I'm not discounting the importance of what's in the head. So let's take this one item at a time. We'll start with a general theory. And again, another one of my favorite quotes by Ernest Hemingway, the best people possess a feeling for beauty, the courage to take risks, the discipline to tell the truth, the capacity for sacrifice. And so I'll be talking about some of those people as we move through this, not just famous adults, but even young people, in fact, more young people than famous adults. Now, I begin every presentation with this diagram because it helps me locate where I am in the nature of my work. All learning, and when I say all learning, I mean from diapers to doctorate, exists on a continuum. And that continuum ranges from deductive, didactic, prescriptive at one end of the continuum to inductive, investigative, and inquiry-oriented at the other end of the continuum. And most of my work, I'm not discounting the importance of people learning their basic skills and getting good scores and tests and all that stuff, but I'm more concerned with people who use their gifts and use their talents to, in this case, make the world a better place. I also believe that if we've got a purpose for gifted education, it's in the lower right-hand corner of this diagram. It's not just to get people to have high test scores or high grade point averages. Those things are important, but I believe that our field should focus singly on developing force people, inventors, designers, creative writers, artists, entrepreneurs, people that are interested in social action. I believe that this is the major purpose of the field, and I think we have young people today that are so concerned with scores and grades and things like that that they're losing sight of some of these more important kinds of things. This next diagram really represents the four areas that I've worked on over the last several years, and many of you are probably familiar with the top two items, the three-ring conception of giftedness and the enrichment triad model. And by the way, GFAK in the enrichment triad model stands for good for all kids. That is, I believe that our field should be making general enrichment opportunities available for all children. And it is from those kinds of opportunities and the ways that certain young people follow up that we're going to find out who is truly the gifted contributors of the next generation. Tonight's work will, big question. I love this quotation. What is the difference that makes a difference? I hope I'll be covering a little bit of that tonight. And I will be focusing on these two bottom sub-theories of this four theoretical model that I've been working on over the last several years. If you're interested in a print copy, it was an article in the Gifted Child Quarterly that appeared sometime in 2013, early in 2013. And you can read about all four of these in great detail. But what I thought I'd do this evening is just talk about what are some of the kinds of skills in these bottom two quadrants of the overall four theories that is the focus of my present work and ongoing research. And so I thought A nice way to begin would be just to talk about a few practical examples. What's this guy talking about anyway? So I'm going to start with a young girl named Auburn Burnside. Auburn Burnside's mother is a social worker, and Auburn was riding with her one day as she was picking up some foster children from one home to take them to another home. And they walked out the door, and they were carrying their clothing in garbage bags. And she said, as you'll see in this quotation, "I thought they must feel like garbage themselves," she said, "and I want to do something about that." She spent the next year, and in fact, several years, as you can see, her website is still available, finding and rehabilitating suitcases so that all the foster children in her city could have a suitcase. This spread to other towns and other places, and she herself has now gone on to study to be a social worker. But this is what I'm talking about: people using their interests, their strengths, their talents, their organizational skills to do good things, to make the life better for other people. This next example is a young girl that I met actually when she was 10 years old. Here she's holding a model of something that you're going to hear about in just a second as I play a short video. Her name is Caroline Mary, M-E-R-R-Y, and that little model that she's holding eventually became a playground in her city because one day she was walking on the playground and she noticed that children with disabilities in wheelchairs or children that use crutches or braces had no place to play. They just stood on the sidelines and basically watched other children playing. And she said, "I want to do something about that." And so she started talking to different people. She started gathering architectural information, companies that manufacture different kinds of playground material. Well, let's just let her tell you about it.
Especially when they step out of their busy school and social lives to reach out to others. Caroline Mary of Parkville is in the zone. She was asked to come up with a solution to a real life problem. She found the problem right at her own school and came up with quite a solution. It's a wonderful sound, children playing, oblivious to the problems around them. For just a moment, they are enjoying their own little world and not a care in it. This is the playground that Caroline built. Caroline Mary saw this playground at Oakley Elementary School in Parkville as a dangerous place where a limited number of children could play. She wanted to make a change.
I saw a need for a new playground because there were kids, at that time, there were two kids that were in wheelchairs, and all they could do was stay on the concrete surface of the playground because there was nowhere else for them to go, much less any ramps for them to get to the pieces of equipment that were accessible.
Caroline's ideas grew out of a school project in the Baltimore County Enrichment Program. The assignment was to find something wrong in your environment and come up with a plan to solve it. She did.
She has so many people involved in this project, in working, going down to Annapolis, working with engineers, working with program designers, and it was a labor of love.
Caroline developed a plan, made a model, worked with architects and designers, and presented her findings to the county. They liked the idea, and she led the forces to raise the money to build her playground.
It's sort of a good feeling. I know I did something to help the community, and every time I pass it, I feel good about myself because I know that I worked hard, and my hard work paid off because now the community has something that everybody can use with no limitations, whether you're in a wheelchair or whether you're just a regular kid wanting to have fun.
She's always been a child that's very empathetic and looking out for others. But I think, if anything, it's matured her. She's become a lot more comfortable in public, but she's the same old kid.
But from now on, thousands of kids will romp and play on the grounds that Caroline Mary built.
Her.
Wonderful young lady. That's
and great. Who better to design a playground than a kid?
Than a kid. You're absolutely right.
They know what they like. That's our report to the moment. CBS Evening News is next. Follow me on our...
There's so many things there, and the reason, again, that I put all these four sub-theories together is I can't separate out where all of these things blend. There's intelligence, there's creativity, there's persistence, task commitment, organizational skills, human interaction skills, research skills. They're all blended in together. And I think that that's a nice example of just how the four theories all fit together. We move on now to a couple of underlying assumptions. I believe that persons with high potential will eventually emerge to important roles in any area that they choose to work, whether that is in religion, whether it's in politics, whether it's in art, in industry, in business. They're going to move up to the top. What kind of people will they be? Will they be good people? Will they be caring people? Will they be people like Caroline Mary, who are using their talents to make the world a better place? I believe that educational institutions and programs that serve high potential young people have a responsibility to provide the kinds of opportunities that you just saw. In the case of Auburn, who got a tremendous amount of help from her resource teacher at her school. In the case of Caroline, many people in the school and the community were able to assist her. Again, I'm going to skip along here just because there's a few things that we need to catch up on some time for. Question, what is social capital and why is it important? I'm going to skip these two quotes. I love this book called Bowling Alone by Robert Putnam. If you haven't had a chance to take a look at that book, what he talks about is a decline that's taken place in society. And I must say that it does focus on mainly on American society, where there seems to be a separation of people, of families, families that don't eat dinner together, families that don't socialize, that don't go out much. They call it nesting. They stay home with their clicker in front of the television set. They're much less active in community organizations, and you'll see some data on this. So my Bible in this work, and something that really inspired me to push ahead with this work, was this book. So take a look at it when you get a chance. Now, I guess that one of the ways to describe what this is all about is to take a look at two people, both very bright, equally educated, have the same background, the same kinds of opportunities. You all recognize this man. He carried off one of the greatest bloodless revolutions in the history of the world. And then we see another man again, equally capable, Idi Amin, and we all know what Idi did to his people, don't we? And so I think that we need to think about this when we talk about these people who will emerge. They will emerge as leaders of business, of industry, of politics, of religion. What kind of people will they be? Now, some of the data is pretty scary here. If you take a look at these charts, and I'm sorry, they're a little bit vague in this light, and especially on that screen that's not as bright. But we see here the difference between youngsters and the development of a philosophy of life and simply in the development of making financial gains. The line that starts at the top is the philosophy of lifeline, and we see that over the years, this has gone down, 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 and just more economic gain has gone up, up, up. And so these are some of the kinds of things that cause me to have to think about what can we do in our programs with these potential future leaders that are going to make changes. You've read the research recently. This just came out last year. Today's kids view cheating as part of their path to success. They don't think that there's anything wrong with cheating. And there's lots and lots of research that's been done on that. This next study by a person named Alyssa Moses looked at the values of global youth throughout the world. And what she found was that the segments that were the more defined, more of young people today, were thrills and chills, resigned, a few world savers, few quiet achievers, but what her research showed was that there are very few people who are in the category, especially of upholders, family, custom, tradition, respect for other individuals, respect for members of their family. Again, there's a lot of data. I'm not going to bore you with a lot of it, but this is a scale that was recently done on college students on a narcissistic scale. narcissistic personality scale. We see again over time, beginning in the 1960s and coming into the early 2000s, we see that narcissism has gone up dramatically among college students. I'm not expecting you to read this next slide. I just want you to know that the slide after it is based on all of those research studies there that I reviewed, about a dozen very important research studies. What research tells us about trends in young people and value system. And this is the summary of those studies: rampant materialism, conspicuous consumption, self-indulgence, narcissism, I won't read them all, lack of interest in the well-being of others, obsession, maximizing personal gains, obsession with the theater of celebrity, substituting virtual for real-world relationships. We hear kids say, yeah, I've got 450 friends on Facebook, but I don't talk to anybody face-to-face. And so these are some of the kinds of changes that are taking place. And again, if we are dealing with people that are in gifted and talented programs and will move on to leadership positions, I think these are some of the kinds of things that we need to deal with. We move into the first sub-theory that I'll be talking about tonight, and it's called Operation Houndstooth because when I originally developed the three-ring conception of giftedness, I embedded the three rings in first a checkerboard design, the checkerboard representing personality and environment. People said, where do the three rings come from? And I said, well, I guess they must come from personality, which is part hereditary, isn't it, and environment. But those two things interact, so I changed the checkerboard to a houndstooth design, and that's how I sort of got stuck with the name Operation Houndstooth. Anyway, this part of my work is trying to encourage more young people to invest in social capital, like the two young ladies that you saw in my example. Social capital is defined as actions that benefit others, single individuals or targeted groups, entire communities. In one case, it was just foster kids who didn't have suitcases. And in the other case, it was just kids that were not a couple of kids or three or four kids that did not have access to a playground. So it doesn't have to be your audience or target, doesn't have to be the whole world. We don't even have a good word for it in English. As distinct from actions that are only taken to benefit one's own financial gain, status, power, or authority, social capital is produced when people take action in the following areas, and you see them: social justice, economic fairness, and ecological environmental presentation, ethical and moral leadership. Now again, we don't have a word for it in English, you see here a word in German, and Hans, I won't try to pronounce that, but lack of ego involvement, focusing on problems outside of ourselves. The Greeks have a word for it called philotomo, giving of yourself and expecting nothing in return. I think that these are some of the kinds of things that I'm trying to promote in this work, and I'm going to move on to our research. My first research study on this was whenever I gave a talk to a group, and many of them were gifted educators, you're going to see a lot of Bloom's taxonomy in their first responses. I asked them to write down on a piece of paper, to list on a piece of paper and pass in to me what is good or intelligent thinking. And I have collected these. I probably have 500-600 that I've collected over the years. And I categorized them, and what I found was that about 82% of them fell pretty much into thinking skills a la, say, Bloom's taxonomy, or the kinds of things that we talk about a great deal as the rationale for gifted education. The others I categorized mainly motivational and practical, and here we see again some of the things that we advocate, more creativity-oriented, impulsive, playfulness, openness, and things like that. Only 4% of the responses fell into what I would call ethical thinking. And these were some of them that people wrote down. These are all from the slips of paper that I collected over the years. Notice, some people said good, intelligent thinking means truthfulness. It means altruism. It means humility and fairness. So I believe that this is the direction. If I did this study 10 years from now, I'd love to see a preponderance or at least an equal number of gift. These were mostly educators of the gifted that I collected these from. I'd like to see an equal number over in the right-hand column. Now, my work's proceeded in a number of phases. The first phase was the development of the theory and carrying out some of the research. You saw the research study there. The second phase was refining and then applying this in various places that we worked. And to start out, I have to say that this is a tough area in which to do research because the concepts are not as precise as what you can measure on intelligence or achievement tests. They're a little bit fuzzy. In fact, when I started working on this, people said, how in the heck are you going to measure things like optimism and courage? We used a technique called the semantic differential technique, a book by a man named Osgood you see in the lower right-hand corner, where I took the words that came out of our factor analysis, you'll see how we got that in a minute, and I put them on a scale with bipolar adjectives and for each of the concepts that we studied, and just asked people to check where the word fell between valuable, not valuable, rational, intuitive, and that helped me to define the concepts. Eventually, these are some of the items that turned up on our scale as a result of this process. I am motivated to improve the quality of life for other people. I am intrigued by unanswered questions in my area of strongest interest. I am optimistic about my future. We also developed a younger children's version. The questions are a little bit easier to read. These are just a few of the sample questions. I am always happy. I help others without being asked. Anyway, that was the content validity end of the study, the semantic differential, expert opinion, classification of the items. We then went into a construct validity phase where we administered the instruments to hundreds and hundreds of people. We ran them through the computer. The computer sorted them out into these six categories. And there you see on our major instrument for middle and grade and above youngsters, you see the number of items per concept and then the reliabilities. And we set the reliability alpha internal consistency reliability cutoff at about 70. And another instrument I'll talk about in a minute, we had to set a little lower. But so anyway, this resulted in, again, what we refer to as Operation Houndstooth. And there you see the six major characteristics: optimism, courage, romance with a topic or discipline. And then you see some sub-characteristics or traits there. For example, a vision and sense of destiny, a sense of power to change things. I can make something right. I can make something work well. I can make this company profitable. Those are the kinds of things that were included. And these are defined. I'm not going to read the definitions, but we did define each of these six items. So that pretty much is a very fast summary of work that I began probably in the early 1980s. It's still going on. We just finished another study. You never study this thing as a whole. You study certain parts of it. For example, one study that was conducted last year by two of my colleagues focused on physical and mental energy and vision and sense of destiny. So you take them one at a time. We now move on to the fourth sub-theory, executive function. And executive functions are broadly defined here as the ability to engage in novel situations that require planning, decision-making, troubleshooting, and ethical leadership. And this is the key, that is not dependent on routine or well-rehearsed responses. I happen to be the husband of the senior vice provost of the University of Connecticut. She received one of your awards this evening. And she has 100 problems a week that cross her desk. She's responsible for the entire academic program, students, faculty, grievances, new hires, promotion, tenure, reappointment. And there's no canned answers for the work that she does. And my good friend Bruce Shore also is in that position, so I'm sure he could give this talk as well. You have to have a lot of on-your-feet thinking. You just can't reach over and say, this is the way we've always done it, and this is the way we always will. It involves organizing, integrating, managing information. Executive function skills are more important for school readiness than our IQ or entry-level reading or math. This is from a very recent research study, and research shows that five-year-olds today are behind in executive functions compared to five-year-olds of a couple of generations ago. Again, this is based on American data. I don't know what international data would say on this. And so we have kids that are coming to school that are not as well organized, that do not get things done the way that they should. A wonderful quotation, what I think is important on the road to success is learning to deal with failure, to manage adversity. That's a skill that parents can certainly help their children develop, and so can teachers and coaches and mentors. And this comes from a very popular book by Paul Toe called How Children Succeed, Grit, Curiosity, and the Hidden Power of Character. And so I don't think that we need to wait till people are in middle school or high school or even college to develop these kinds of things. I think we need to start to develop them at a very early age. In this work, again, the instrument development followed the same pattern as the instruments we developed for Operation Houndstooth. We start with content validity, and we get a number of factors that usually that come from the research literature, and then we ask people with some background to rate them as to whether or not they are, for example, pays attention, what category does that fall into. All of this leads to then the development of a student instrument. And here we see some examples from the instrument that measures executive functions. We ask, in this case, students to put a yes or no if this word is characteristic of them. The next step is, again, computer-related construct validity. You give this to thousands and thousands of subjects. You then run that information through the machine. And these are the factors that resulted from that. And we did set our alpha level here at about 70 as well. Action orientation, what motivates you to succeed? And here you see, again, some of the items that are related to that. Social interactions, how do you successfully interact with others? Leadership, what characteristics do you have to be a successful leader? Realistic self-assessment, how are you aware of your own abilities? And last one, awareness of the needs of others. And this does interact a little bit with the skills in Houndstooth as well. So we're going to move along just because of time, and I'm going to share an example with you, and then we're going to wrap this up. This is someone once said that my answer to every question is type 3 enrichment in the triad model. In fact, the two things that you already saw, the suitcase example and the Merry Little Playground, are both things that came from type 3 enrichment projects. But here's one that shows a lot of these things put together. And afterwards, I'm going to share some of the resources that these kids use to develop this. And so hoping everything works one more time. And again, this was a result of a gifted program where we asked young people, like in community problem solving, to look around their home, their school, their community, and find something that they think needs fixing. And what these kids found that needs fixing is something that's very wasteful in many, many schools in America, and I imagine in other countries as well, probably more so in America. So let's take a look at this, and then we'll talk about it.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Yeah.
My baby dance me. See your hand.
using wasteful styrofoam trays, we thought we could use these biodegradable trays instead. They are made out of unprocessed food pulp and bagasse sugar canery, both very renewable resources, and can fully biodegrade in only 90 days. All we needed now was an idea in order to remain economically efficient. We brainstormed and crunched numbers until we finally thought of an idea. The cost to upgrade from styrofoam to biodegradable is only $16,700. Divided among the 180 school days and the 3,100 meals we serve every day, that is only 3 cents per meal. This cost could be offset many different ways, one of those ways being directly absorbing it into the student body. That is less than $1 a month, and equates to only $9 over the course of a school year. Other options include applying for federal grants or having the costs associated with the trays absorbed to the $113,000 that Winter Food Service made in profit last school year. However, a slight increase in lunch price is most plausible since the lunch costs will be increasing due to the food prices regardless. With the cost problem solved, we moved on to the tough task of pleasing the student body. The students were well aware of the tray issue at Windsor High and had already formed strong opinions about the trays and their environmental impact. When asked about the new biodegradable trays, an overwhelming majority loved the idea.
Well, this will be better for the environment.
I mean, look at them. They're strong, they're durable, and biodegradable. I mean, how can you lose?
These are biodegradable, which is plus. So.
Ooh, that one's nice.
It's got a good feel to it. It feels pretty sturdy.
Not only were they excited for the new trays, but they absolutely despised the styrofoam.
I hate these ones.
Sometimes things break during lunch if you have a lot to carry.
I'm uncomfortable to carry and they don't fit anything.
Yeah, no, I don't like the styrofoam ones. They're really clumsy and they break right here.
Yes, it's definitely bad.
It would make it worth it to actually bother going to lunch because I hate styrofoam.
Teachers were also on board with the idea.
So I definitely hate and dislike those styrofoam because they are bad for nature and with the nature. Yeah, absolutely. I would do anything to get rid of that styrofoam.
To solidify these opinions, we held a tray day at our school and collected data on what the student body thought about these biodegradable trays. Each randomly selected student filled out a survey on whether or not they liked the biodegradable trays. The results were overwhelmingly positive. Over 85% of the students wanted to switch from styrofoam to biodegradable lunch trays. With this data to back us up, we went to the Windsor Food Service Director, Dana Plant. She agreed to do further research on the biodegradable trays after hearing information from composting specialist Paul Gibson. We were able to get all the styrofoam trays in the bagel and wrap lines replaced with paper boats, which, while not biodegradable, are many times better for the environment than harmful polystyrene, which I hope comes as no newsflash. These boats will be used during the transition phase between styrofoam and our ultimate goal, biodegradable trays.
I'm going to stop it. So, again, we see so many skills and talents and abilities there. How do kids get this knowledge? One of the things that we lean very heavily on in our work is what we call how-to books. Getting young people, for example, here you see one of my favorites, Barbara Lewis's book, A Kid's Guide to Social Action. How do you develop a petition? How do you approach a public officials and ask if you can develop a proposal? How do you write a proposal? Kids Guide to Service Learning, Kids Guide to Service Project. These are the kinds of things. I think I've got this slide in twice. I know. What we call in Triad, again, type 2 enrichment. And so I think our role as educators is not just to inspire kids to want to do these kinds of things, but also to give them the skills that they go out and do it in as professional a way as possible. And there's a lot more to what we do here, but again, we're covering this pretty fast. Last point on the outline, and that is yet another sub-theory. And this is interventions designed to promote both the characteristics in Operation Houndstooth and the traits and characteristics related to executive function. And I've been studying these for a number of years, and at first they were two separate interventions, but they overlap so much that I made them into just one intervention. And so we start out with the methods on the left, and then the internalization of these values on the right. I don't want kids to do them for all the wrong reasons. I want them to do them because it becomes a part of their heart and soul and being. They're doing them because it makes them feel good to do something for others. And in this little diagram that's going to climb up the screen here, the items at the bottom are, the research has shown, are the least effective in internalizing these values in young people. The first one I call rally round the flag. That's posters, you know, I am a good citizen, and things that are read over the intercom in the morning, that we take oaths to the flag and to the country and to be good. I just ran across this one. This is a third grade that daily has to recite a pledge to be intellectually active, humble, and kind to others. And I asked some of the kids in the classroom, well, what does that mean to you? And one kid, as he stuck his foot out to trip another kid, said, I don't know what that means. So these things don't internalize well. You know, the person that's going to church every Sunday drives around the parking lot and cuts off somebody to get a better parking spot. So the second is what I call the gold star approach. And this is rewards, giving kids medals, rewards, recognitions. And I think, again, these, I'm not saying that these are unhelpful. They just don't have a lot to do with internalizing the value that we're trying to get across. Sometimes kids are doing it to get the gold star, but it doesn't internalize very well. The next is the teaching and preaching approach. We try to teach kids lessons about character development, about honesty, about ethics. And by the way, the track record here is very dismal. One of the best studies that I read was studies of young people in Europe that were in young communist leagues. As soon as the wall, they only went so they'd get the red scarf and the summer trip to the Black Sea. When the wall came down, they said, we don't believe any of that junk. We just did it because we got certain rewards for it. The next one, a little bit more, has a little bit more power for internalization, simulations or vicarious experiences, where you actually put children in a situation where there is some conflict, let's say a bullying situation where children play the role of the bullier and the person to be bullied, and then they reverse roles. And this does have a little bit more power toward internalizing that value. The next is direct involvement one, and that's participation in an activity where you're trying to bring about some action or some social change, social action, entrepreneurship, as I like to call it. Working in a food kitchen, for example, or working in serving as a volunteer in a daycare center or a senior citizen center. That seems to cause more internalization of the values. The last one is what I call direct involvement to creative productive activities, where this is real pure type three, where you're coming up with the idea, as Auburn came up with the idea of collecting the suitcases, and as Caroline came up with the idea of actually designing the playground. So it's more than just participating as one would work as a volunteer, but it's actually some creative action. And we've added those two. So now the two words that you've been dying to hear, in conclusion, we're gonna, my favorite quotation by Mahatma Gandhi, the things that will destroy us are politics without principle. Every time you pick up the newspaper in the US, another politician is going to jail or cheating on Wall Street. Politics without principle, pleasure without conscience, wealth without work, knowledge without character, business without morality, science without humanity, and worship without sacrifice. And I think that a very quick summary, these are the traditional focus of gifted education, creative thinking, critical thinking, problem solving. And I am not, will not, nor ever will argue against the importance of those. They're the foundation of gifted education in our work. By the way, I don't think that those things have any great value until they're brought to bear upon an opportunity for creative productivity. The young people that I mentioned, the people that did the styrofoam, getting rid of the styrofoam trays for more biodegradable ones, they wouldn't have done that if, in fact, there was not a creative opportunity for them to take some action. So I think that those will always be the traditional focus, but in this case, we're adding in these two areas. The bottom area is work in progress, but the intelligence is outside the normal curve relating to houndstooth. You see the six houndstooth characteristics there. And the soft intelligences, again, the executive functions, personal, emotional, motivational, responsible, organizational. These are all the things that should be part and parcel of the curriculum, of the things that we do for high potential young people in our programs. And with a slightly modified quote by Ashley Montague, and some of these kids are sitting in your class right today. He says, teachers are the unacknowledged legislators of the world. Well, I've just added, teachers of the gifted are the unacknowledged legislators of our future leaders of the world. So I'll end with one of my favorite cartoons. People ask, what am I working on now? This is a family going across the desert, and the father is turning around talking to the rest of the family, and he doesn't look too happy. I sometimes ask people, what do you think he's saying? Stop asking me if we're almost there. We're nomads, for crying out loud. So in this field, we've got to be nomads. We've shown a lot of leadership for general education. A lot of people working in general education have taken their leads from what we've done, and we've got to continue that leadership. So I end, I thank you for your kind attention, and I wish you happiness always. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, Joe, I'd like to thank you for sharing your perspective on these important topics about creativity and talent development and social capital and using our gifts in positive ways. Martin Luther King has said something to the effect that all of us are going to have to choose whether to walk in the darkness of destructive selfishness or in the light of creative altruism. And I think Joe has shown us the path. So Joe, thanks most of all for reminding us that morality matters and for modeling that of which you speak. Okay, thank you. And now Julia will announce the reception.
And may I invite you to the reception, and I do want Dr. Sam Evans, Dean of the College of Education of and Behavioral Sciences at Western Kentucky University, just to stand. He is making... He is sponsoring the reception that we're going to have, and let's go enjoy each other's company and get